Symphony Orchestra concert with their brilliant conductor, Dr. Laurie Redmer Kellwaller. So, you know, to play in an orchestra, you need not only musical talent, but years of practice, training, determination, discipline. You need to listen well to others. You need to follow the instructions of the conductor. You need to understand the emotions, the sentiment, the character of the piece that you are playing. And when all that comes together, the miracle of music happens. The music of these world changers like Beethoven, Elgar, Wagner, Brahms, Kavalevsky, and many others fill the space with light, hope. It connects us with beauty. It connects us with ourselves, with others, and with God. So we are here to experience that beauty and all the marvelous things that music gives us. And I know that after this concert, we will be feeling better people, because that is what great music does. So we welcome you, we welcome the orchestra, and let us open this concert with a word of prayer, just like we are. Father in heaven, thank you very much for your Sabbath. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be here and share beauty through music. Thank you very much for the students and the faculty and staff that came from Tennessee to California to bring these beautiful gifts to us, to the community, and to make this world a better place through fine art. Thank you for the opportunity to enjoy this together today. And we ask you, God, to bless them, to bless the orchestra, the conductor, so they can see all the work, all the preparation, all their tuning, not only their instruments, but also their hearts with you, happening as we listen to them and we enjoy this sonic feast together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Should have gone off the other side. Good afternoon, good evening. I'm never sure what 5 o'clock is. I'll just say good evening. Thank you so much for your warm welcome, and we loved being a part of the worship services this morning. It's always wonderful for us to get to worship with like believers, no matter where we are. And that is one of the privileges. When we're in Collegedale, at home at Southern, we play because we don't have a performing arts center. So what we do is we play all of our concerts in the church sanctuary. And it's one of the challenges for me, for programming, to do things that are appropriate for a church sanctuary. But it's also requires us to be a part of the worship services because all of our stuff is on the stage. So we participate in worship services all the time, and it's one of the joys of us. We are out here in California on a 12-day tour. This is our spring break, and of course, we brought the rain. It seems we went to Florida the end of January, and it was cold. We went to Barcelona, and it snowed in Barcelona for the first time in 25 years. So I think it's me. I'm not quite sure, but it could be that. That first piece, you can see from our program that we're doing selections. Trust me, we're not doing all the pieces that are listed. I'm sure you'll be somewhat relieved by that. But we started off with the Imperial March by Sir Edward Elgar. And as you know, Elgar was one of the most prolific and beloved composers in England. And anytime you can write for an imperial march as the British Empire marched across the world, it was a good thing. So that was what we started with. We're going to go next to the George Whitefield Chadwick Symphonic Sketches. Now Chadwick was, you can see his dates in the program, Chadwick was one of the second school of New England. He was up in the Boston area. He was a composer from the second school of New England composers. And he wrote a lot of music, which we don't know all that well. And so we're doing the first, there are four movements to the symphonic sketches. We've brought two of them on tour, and we're only doing the first one for you tonight. So this is Jubilee from Symphonic Sketches by George Whitefield Chadwick. Thank you. Isn't it great to hear some new music? Have any of you ever heard of George Whitefield Chadwick? Oh, a few. Well, that's wonderful. But for most of us, it's brand new music. And that's kind of rare, considering how old that music is. So that's fun for us. We're just getting set up for the... You can go. Every year, the Southern Orchestra hosts a concerto competition. And we've had some students from the Loma Linda area come out and perform with the orchestra. And it's always wonderful. What we do instead of having one person play an entire concerto is that we have six or seven people play one movement of a concerto. So more people have the opportunity to be a part of that experience, because it's not very often that you get to. And so this year, Zachary Ramont was one of the winners of the concerto competition, and he played with the orchestra in February. And Zach has some family out in this area. He's from Tennessee. He's from Colorado. Oh, there they are waving. He has family. His parents flew out for this, and so I've asked Zach if he would play the first movement of the Kabalevsky Violin Concerto. Zach is a homeschooler. He's 16 years old. He's a junior in high school. And so this is the Kabalevsky Violin Concerto first movement. Thank you. the church has very kindly offered to take up an offering. So we're going to add something to the program that may not make the media team very happy, but we're going to add the slow movement, one of the slow movements, from the Elgar Enigma Variations. It's a piece that I consider four of the most beautiful minutes of music ever written. Elgar's Enigma Variations, you can read up about it. It's an amazing piece. It's a wonderful piece. Nimrod is number 9 in the group, and Elgar wrote these movements to describe his friends. And we know who most of them are, but he never divulged where the theme came from. He never told anyone. And so that's part of the mystery of this piece and why it's called Enigma. But this was called, this one is movement that we're going to play during the offering is called Nimrod. And you'll just hear how it starts out with this incredible melody that just builds and builds and builds to this huge climax and then just drops away into nothing. So I hope you can just lean back and revel in the joy of this particular piece.
Thank you.
Do you agree with me? It's astonishing, astonishing music. We're going to end, I know it seems we just began, but we're going to end with Dvorak Symphony number 8. And you can see from the program that it's got 4 movements. We're going to play them all. One of the trickiest things for any academic conductor is choosing music for the first concert of the year. It's something that some people don't think about, is that I have a new orchestra every year. I never have the same 75 players. So when we start in late August, when school begins, I'm starting from scratch. Yes, I get people who've been in the orchestra for 3 years coming back for their final year. Some people take a little longer to graduate and get to be with me a little longer, but that's okay. I welcome them back every year too. But every year, so the trick is I can't put Mahler Symphony number 1 in the first concert because we're not mature enough as a group. We haven't developed a group sound. We haven't worked on that. So it's always a trick. And I find that Dvorak is a wonderful composer for our first, because he challenges us just enough to push us, and yet he's accessible enough that we can be successful in that first concert, because we have our first concert in 6 weeks. So you think about in an academic musical setting, we take our exams in public. That's what we're doing today. It's not many other academic disciplines that have to do that on a regular basis, and we do it every 5 or 6 weeks. So I tell the orchestra that I get a miracle every 5 or 6 weeks. Because if you could hear us at our first rehearsal when we're sight reading a piece, you would also start praying for a miracle. So it's one of those things. So this is Dvorak Symphony number 8.
Thank you. Thank you.